Creation theme in selected Psalms. We've been looking at the Genesis account of origins and its reverberations in the Old Testament. There's a couple of new books, both edited by Joe Klingbeil, the Genesis creation account, and he spoke in it was the covers for the books. We are now on chapter 6 in both books, which parallel each other. The creation theme in selected Psalms, and this is written by Alexej Muráň. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. It was apparently a PhD candidate. My guess is that he was doing something on the Genesis account in Psalms anyway, and so they said, why don't you just write up some of what you found? He's at Andrews University. With that introduction, we'll take a look at Psalms. Other than Psalm 104, creation doesn't figure as a major theme, but it figures as a minor one. There are those who want to make it almost non-existent, but I think, as we'll see, the theme of creation itself is definitely in Psalms. To begin with his introduction, the primary purpose of this study is to examine the creation theme in the book of Psalms as it relates to the larger context of individual Psalms. Although creation is not considered the most significant theme, it is clearly present throughout the Psalms. As a part of an overall look at the creation theme, the major focus of this study will be on creation as a supportive theme in the Psalms. Some of the issues addressed in the study will include the following questions. Which themes use creation references in a secondary manner? How is the creation theme used? How does it influence and support the rest of the psalm? The psalmists often speak about the creator and creation and use creation imagery or creation language. However, to classify a psalm as a creation psalm is difficult, since creation is rarely a main theme of the psalm, the only exception being Psalm 104, which you may remember we just went over for 2 weeks, which is considered to be a creation psalm by most scholars. I would hope so. Creation may not be the only theme in this psalm, but it seems to be the major theme. Therefore, Psalm 104 requires separate study and will be omitted in this chapter, although we've been through it for the last 2 weeks. The psalms included will be limited to those in which a clear reference to creation can be noted. And sometimes not so clear, as we'll see. Classification of the themes related to creation. In examining the use of creation as a supportive theme in the book of Psalms, 12 different primary themes stood out. These can be further divided into three groups. Themes in the first group pertain to the knowledge of God. This is the most prominent use of the creation theme in the book of Psalms. In this group, creation is the reason to praise God. It describes who God is. More specifically, it portrays his power. And finally, it shows that God as creator is also sustainer of his creation. The second group is a continuation of the theme of God as sustainer, but it specifically deals with humans rather than the general creation. It starts with a description of human existence, clarifying the difference between God and humans. The second point portrays a God who is different from his creation and at some points seemingly distant from his creation. After understanding the difference between humans and the seemingly distant creator, creation shows that it is safe to trust in God who is ready to bless his creation. The last group delves further into the relationship between God and humanity. It is based on the law of God, which, according to a supportive creation theme, was established at the beginning by God the Creator. After a description of the law, the creation theme gives God the right to judge as the one who created everything and as the one who set the rules in place so everyone would work in perfect order. Everything would work in perfect order. Creation is also used to show who the wicked are. However, it also shows that there is salvation and restoration emanating from God, who has the power to save. The book of Psalms includes several other minor themes that are linked to the creation theme, such as joy or instructions about creation. It should be pointed out that the actual creation process is never the main theme of creation in the book of Psalms, the only arguable exception being Psalm 104, which we've seen before. In the same way, creation is never used as a major theme throughout a psalm, again, with the possible, probable exception of 104. There are psalms, such as Psalm 8 or Psalm 29. Psalm 8 we're going to read. Psalm 29, I'm not sure why he's including here, because I read it and it doesn't seem to have any particular relevance to the subject, which include major creation references. However, the main purpose of these large sections is not the actual creation process, but one of the previously mentioned themes. Therefore, we can conclude that except for Psalm 104, there is no creation psalm, but only psalms with a creation as a secondary or even a tertiary theme, which we'll have. Praise of God. So this is beginning of his 12 things to look at. God's praise is a central theme of the book of Psalms. While it is not necessarily found in every psalm, it is the most recurring theme in the entire book. Well, you kind of expect that. There are 8 different Hebrew terms in the Psalms that express the idea of praise. Combined, they occur 186 times in 150 psalms, which is quite a bit. The poets not only exhorted the people, but also every living thing to praise the Lord. The praise of God is so closely related to the book of Psalms, is closely related to the book of Psalms as well as to creation. Solid evidence suggests that the praise of God is the central reason for the creation theme in the book of Psalms. In fact, some scholars argue that outside Genesis 1 and 2, creation appears in the setting of praise in the rest of the Bible, I guess. The praise of God may not always be a direct and immediate result of a creation reference, but it can be implied or found in the larger context of the Psalms. One example of a reference with a lack of specific praise of God is found in Psalm 119:73. In this verse, the psalmist calls on God the Creator to give him the understanding of the law. The immediate result of the creation reference is the Creator's ability to teach the writer his laws. And for those of you who have forgotten Psalm 119:73, thy hands have made me and fashioned me. Give me understanding that I may learn thy commandments. This is in a psalm that has 176 verses, longest chapter in the entire Bible. And all of them have to do with the law, all different ways of referring to the law. Each letter gets 8 verses. And this one starts out with the creation theme and then, of course, moves on to the law. In the introductory Aleph section of the psalm, the psalmist says that learning God's law results in the praise of God. Therefore, the psalmist's call on the Creator to give him understanding of the law should eventually result in praise. Now, that's kind of a secondary inference, but it's probably a valid one. Psalm 100. This is the only psalm with the title Mizmor L'Todah, Psalm for Thanksgiving. The structure of this psalm is very similar to that of 95, 1 through 7a, and we're going to look at 95 in just a little bit. It starts with a call to praise and then gives a reason for the praise, followed by another call and a reason to praise. It is possible to interpret this as a reference to the creation of a nation. However, because of its close relationship with Psalm 95, it should also be understood in the context of the creation of humans. And anything in yellow is my ellipses or comments. And here's Psalm 100. I'm sure most of you are familiar with it. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands, and so forth. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that has made us, and not we ourselves. So we have a reference to creation, not a 6-day, 24-hour contiguous creation, but a creation. And that's the reason that we can enter into his gates with thanksgiving and so forth. And Psalm 95 follows much the same for the first little bit. O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving, for the Lord is a great God. The sea is his, and he made it. His hands formed the dry land. Let us worship Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. And then, for He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture and the sheep of His hands. And you'll notice that until then, it's fairly parallel to Psalm 100. Then, of course, it goes into this. Today, if you'll hear His voice, harden not your heart, which passage figures strongly in the book of Hebrews. Oh, and one other thing about Psalm 95 that's interesting. If you look down here, unto whom I swear in my wrath that they should not enter into my rest. And in Hebrews, that's strongly connected with the Sabbath, interestingly enough. Psalm 148. This psalm contains the most detailed call for all creation to praise God. It starts with an appeal to the heavenly realms and to the sun, moon, and stars. In the Psalms, this is always the order in which creation is presented. Heaven and things relating to heaven are mentioned first, followed by earth. Praise always begins with a look at the sky, and the heavens are first telling of the glory of God. In Psalms 19:1, this is the only mention of Psalm 19, which is too bad. We'll come back to that at the end. Psalm 148, you'll notice we start out with praise ye the Lord from the heavens, praise Him from the heights, praise Him the angels, all His host, ye heaven of heavens, ye waters that be above the heavens. So all about the heavens, let them praise the name of the Lord, for He commanded and they were created. There's a reference to creation. He also established them forever and ever, which is another theme in Psalms that God not only created, but He established. He made a decree which shall not pass. I assume which the creation shall not pass. Praise the Lord from the earth. Now we get to the earth. Dragons and all deeps, fire and hail, snow and vapors, stormy wind, fulfilling His words. Mountains and all hill, fruitful trees and all cedars. And you notice that it's actually slightly out of order from the Genesis account. This is more moving from the heavens to the earth than it is. Because the third day here is coming before the fourth day, or coming after the fourth day, which is before that, the sun and moon. Beasts and all cattle, creeping things and flying things. This is more emphasizing the fact of creation rather than the order. Both young men and maidens, old men and children, notice that this is now starting to get very inclusive, presumably because of the creation theme, which covers everybody, not just descendants of Israel. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for His name alone is excellent. His glory is above the earth and heavens. He hath exalted the horn of His people, and so forth. Praise ye the Lord, which is, of course, in Hebrew, hallelujah. God is the creator not only of the earth, but also of the heavens. Most of the time, creation is presented from the perspective of a sinful world. Therefore, almost every reference to creation will include a reference or an allusion to the life and death cycle. So, and of course, that's true with Psalm 104, as you may remember. Therefore, one of the reasons for using creation references in connection with the praise of God is to include every created being in the call to praise the Creator of heaven and earth, making its effect universal, which in some ways it's too bad that Judaism and in some senses Christianity has missed that universal call. In Psalm 33, this psalm of praise includes clear references to creation as the first motivation for praise. After the appeal to praise God with a singing and the playing of instruments, the psalmist provides the reason for this joyful call. Because the word of the Lord is upright. Verse 4, and here we go with, I take it back, it's coming. The first motivation for praising Yahweh is grounded in His essential character. God's word is faithful, loving righteousness and justice, showing His loving kindness to the earth. The description of the word continues with its power to create. This description comprises four parallel lines. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made by the breath of His mouth. The host was made. He spoke, it was done. He commanded, and it stood. The word of the Lord has power, and all the creation that the psalmist sees is the result of this word. And to look at the original again, or at least one English translation of the original, King James in this case, he loveth righteousness and judgment. The earth is full of the goodness of the Lord. That's verse 5. By the word of the Lord the heavens were made, and all the host of them by the breath of his mouth. And then, interestingly, the creation account continues. He gathereth the water of the sea together as in heap. He layeth up the depths in storehouse. So there is that thought that there are some of the specific things that God did in creation are mentioned. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. Notice, that, again, you have the theme of, maybe not praise, but certainly wonder and worship. For he spake, and it was done. He commanded, and it stood fast. Some of us memorized verse 6 and 9 and forgot to look at the verses in between. And then 10 has another theme. Psalm 92 is the only psalm that is clearly associated with the Sabbath. The superscription calls it a psalm, a song for the Sabbath day. This psalm's connection to creation has been recognized by many scholars, and again, for good reason. It brings out two aspects of Sabbath worship, and at the same time, two aspects of the Creator. They are creation and redemption, corresponding to the two versions of the fourth commandment, interestingly enough. As a concluding of this day, of the six-day creation, God's rest on the seventh day signifies the completion of God's very good creation. At the same time, it is the seventh day that points to the restoration of God's creation through his redeeming act, clearly seen in the history of Israel and foreshadowing the final eschatological restoration. So there are two themes that are being intertwined here. It is a good thing to give thanks to the Lord and to sing praise to thy name, O Most High. And then, for thou, Lord, hast made me glad through thy work. I will triumph in the works of thy hands. O Lord, how great are thy works. Again, clearly God made stuff. And this is important. My thoughts are very deep. A brutish man knoweth not, neither doth a fool understand this. And it goes on to talk about the wicked from there on out. The first section is a call to praise, which correlates to the theme of the day that God has consecrated and blessed. In the final verse of this section, the writer declares that the reason for this his gladness to be what you have done and the works of your hands. In other psalms, this Hebrew expression points back to creation. The second section starts with the theme of creation, repeating the praise of God's works. It is the understanding of these works that separates the intelligent from the stupid man. Moving from verse 6 to 7, the senseless and stupid man become the wicked. Verse 7 introduces a new topic and a second Sabbath theme, which is redemption. And moving on to the next section, we don't have time to read the entire book. But we'll give you the highlights, the most important parts of it, and the conclusion pretty much in toto. The creation theme also can be used as a means to reveal who God is. The answer to the question, who is God, in this case, is limited only to the primary understanding of God as the other, the creator, the one who is in contrast to everyone and everything else, partly because of his creation and partly because of his continuing power. Psalm 113, this psalm is the first in the group of so-called Hallel psalms. Since most of them begin and end with the call to praise the Lord, their primary theme is the praise of God. There are many references to creation are a direct result of a close relationship between the praise of God and creation. And Psalm 113, praise ye the Lord, praise ye O you servants of the Lord, praise the name of the Lord, bless the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised. The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory above the heavens. Who is like unto our God, who dwelleth on high, who humbleth himself to behold the things that are in heaven and in the earth? He raiseth the poor out of the dust, and lifteth the needy out of the dunghill. Now, the raising the poor out of the dust kind of alludes a little bit to that we were created from dust. That he may set him with princes, even the princes of his people. He maketh the barren woman to keep house and to be a joyful mother of children. Praise ye the Lord. Now, I will have to say that the reference to creation is not nearly as explicit here as it is in some of the other examples that were given. Psalm 113 is connected with the Song of Hannah. Parallels between these two songs are striking, particularly considering the fact that both use the imagery of God as creator. In Psalm 113, there are several allusions to creation, beginning with a glance towards the heavens. Often in the book of Psalms, the phrase, the glory of God is above the heavens, is found in the context of creation. And so in this case, we can assume that verse 4 also alludes to creation. Again, this is kind of second order, third order inference rather than anything that's directly spoken. Verse 7 to 9 show two cases of the Creator God coming down to finite humans. God is the one who raises the poor from the dust, alluding to Genesis 2:7, where God formed a man out of this same substance. And skipping along to Psalm 90, this is a psalm ascribed to Moses. Because the meter is not uniform, its form is difficult to reconstruct. However, as noted by Voss, despite textual and critical problems, the psalm is highly artistic in its composition. He divides this psalm into four sections, which I'm going to skip. Oh, well, no, I'm not. The invocation of God, the petitioner expressing need, prayer asking for God's intervention and prospect of future salvation, and the invocation of God contains a creation theme. Reference to the birth of mountains does not only indicate that God is their creator, but shows that God was present at the time that they were created. And there's a more explicit comment shortly after that. He was present before everything was created. The contrast between the creator God and the mountains seems to have dethroned the mountains as gods. Which, if you'll remember, mountains around everywhere have been worshipped for a long time. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. This is just the beginning of Psalm 90, but you can see the theme of creation. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hadst formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Presumably the mountains were brought forth by God in this telling. Thou turnest man to destruction, and saith, to return ye children of men, for 1,000 years in thy sight are. But yesterday, when it is past, as a watch in the night, here's the eternal creator being portrayed. And Psalm goes on there from there. God's power. Psalm 74. Psalm 74 is a lament describing the absence and silence of God. The center of the Psalm of Asaph contains allusions to creation, verses 12 through 17, which we'll pay special attention to, which recall God's power in creation and the Exodus. Furthermore, this power is closely related to the salvation of God, which is the subject matter of the psalmist in the rest of the psalm. And in that part too, many scholars have tried to distinguish between these two themes, that is, the creation and the Exodus. However, as Krauss correctly points out, this is not necessarily a question of either or, that there's some mixing between the two. Both of these themes become part of Israel's experience and become part of who God is. He is not the God of one or the other, but the God of all creation and the God of the Exodus. And to refresh your memory, why withdrawest thy hand, even thy right hand? Pluck it out of thy bosom, for God is my King of old, working salvation in the midst of the earth. Thou didst divide the sea by thy strength. Is that Exodus or is that Genesis? Your mileage will vary depending on how you feel, I guess. Thou breakest the head of the dragons in the water. Certainly that's not part of Exodus imagery. Thou breakest the head of Leviathan in pieces and gave him to be meat to the people inhabiting the wilderness. That is, cleave the fountain and the flood. Thou driest up the mighty rivers. The day is thine, the night also is thine. Thou hast prepared the light and the sun. Now there's one that kind of refers to the sun and light, almost separating those two, as in Genesis 1:1, the first day and the fourth day. Thou hast set all the borders of the earth. Thou hast made summer and winter. That sounds like something that happened at the end of the flood. Psalm 89, the Psalm of Ethan the Ezrahite, includes at least six clear references to creation. The section that is most evidently tied to the theme of the power of God is found in verses 9 through 13, which describes the power of God's arm and right hand. They are both in construct form, with the noun often translated as strength, power, or might. And here's the context of Psalm 89, that God stills the raging of the sea. Thou hast broken Rahab in pieces. Rahab is the proud one in Hebrew. As one that is slain, thou scattered thine enemies with thy strong arm. The heavens are thine, the earth also is thine. As for the world and the fullness thereof, thou hast founded them. There is a clear reference to creation. The north and the south, thou hast created them. Tabor and Hermon shall rejoice in thy name. God as sustainer. Psalm 65 is David's song of praise. Without ceasing, it praises God for his works. It begins with praise and is followed by the blessing of the elect, themes which are often found together in the context of creation. This psalm can be divided into three parts. And this is obviously the middle. Excuse me. By terrible things and righteousness wilt thou answer us, O God of our salvation, who art the confidence of all the ends of the earth and of them that are far from the sea, which by his strength setteth fast the mountains, being girded with power. So God created the mountains. And the rest of that is not really creation, but it gives you an idea of what the psalm does with that particular passage. Psalm 147 includes four clear references to creation. In verses 8 and 9, God is described as provider for his creation. This is 8 and 9. Who covereth the heavens with clouds, who prepareth rain for the earth, who maketh grass to grow upon the mountains, he giveth the beast his food, and to the young ravens which cry. I will have to confess that sounds more like maintenance than it does creation. A God who manages things in the present and not one who created them in the first place, although certainly one who created them in the first place would be charged with their maintenance and would be able to do so. So that's one I think he was reaching just a little bit for. As pointed out in the introduction, the second major group of four themes focuses on the relationship between the Creator and creation. That is, who are we? These themes are often interchangeable and at times overlapped with the previous four themes. Who are we? Who we are is closely linked to who God is. Trust in God is directly connected to knowing God as the sustainer. God's capacity to bless is closely associated with his power to bless. And so we have Psalm 8, which he referenced earlier, you may remember, is often referred to as a song of creation. It comes very close to being a creation psalm, with most verses dedicated to creation. However, clearly seen in the inclusio, its main focus is the praise of God. And to remind you, this psalm begins with, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth, and it finishes with the same words, who has set thy glory above the heavens. And this is one of the things that kind of gives us hints that God's glory above the heavens has to do with creation. Out of the mouths of babes and sucklings is that ordained strength because of thine enemies. You may remember Jesus quoted that thou might still the enemy and the avenger. When I consider thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars, which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him? And the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels and hast crowned him with glory and honor. Thou hast made him to have dominion. This harks directly back to the story of Genesis. Over the works of thy hands hast put all things under his feet. And then there's a list of all the things that are under his feet, finishing up with, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. Psalm 139. Psalm 139 is a highly personal depiction of the intimacy between David and his creator. James Luther Mays calls it the most personal expression in scriptures of the Old Testament's radical monotheism. Verses 13 through 16 point to the amazing way God created humans. It is written as a confession of the psalmist expressing his amazement over his own intricate body. You may remember this. Thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. My substance was not hidden from thee when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lower parts of the earth. Interesting that they put that in the mother's womb. My eyes did see my substance, yet being imperfect. In thy books all of my members were written, in which continuance were fashioned, when as yet there were none of them. And that passage really is, again, more of a maintenance thing than an actual creation thing. Certainly not the kind of thing that you would ordinarily use to show that there's a creation theme in Psalms. But it kind of fits in. Psalm 90 and 113, both of these psalms have already been analyzed in connection with the question of who God is. However, they also show who people are in contrast with God, and I won't go over them again. The distance of God. Clearly, God is very different from his creation. He is not limited by space, sustenance, or even time, which is, of course, in contrast to the creation. Psalm 89. In Psalm 89, the people are called B'nai Adam, or sons of man. Literally, sons of Adam, if you're going to be pushy about it. And not sons of Abraham or sons of Israel, suggesting that the Psalms want to, at least in some way, speak to all mankind, not just to the Jews. Trust in God. Psalm 146. Psalm 146 is the first of the final section of Hillel Psalms. Its overall theme is the praise of God, but in the middle it elaborates on a theme of trust. Put not your trust in princes, nor the son of man, in whom there is no help. His breath goeth forth, he returneth to his earth, and that very day his thoughts perish. And that just sounds like the reverse of Genesis 2. Happy is that people that hath the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God, rather than in man. Because the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all therein is. That is, of course, a direct quote from Exodus, which keepeth trust forever, which executeth judgment of the oppressed, and which giveth food to the hungry. The Lord looseth the prisoners, and so forth. Divine blessing. Psalm 115. It starts out with a passage that's quite lengthy that I won't quote the whole thing on. Their idols are silver of gold, the works of men's hands. They have mouths, but they speak not. Eyes have they, but they see not. And ears, but they hear not, and so forth. Then it goes on to say, "You are blessed of the Lord," which of course is in contrast to these idols. The Lord, which made the heaven and earth. The heaven, even the heavens, are the Lord's, because he made them. But the earth hath he given to the children of men. God's law, and it, of course, quotes Psalm 119 and reviews that a little bit. God is judge, which we won't pay too much attention to. Psalm 96 is in most of the Psalms to God's judgment is seen as a positive thing, which is, of course, the difference from the way many of us instinctively view it. All of creation, including the heavens, seas, trees, and fields, rejoice because God is coming to judge the world. This is Psalms 96. Declares glory among the heathen, his wonders among all peoples. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. And this is a nutshell of the previous psalm we looked at. For all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Say among the heathen that the Lord reigneth. The world shall be established, that it shall not be moved. He shall judge the people righteously. There's the judgment that comes from the fact that God made the heavens. Who are the wicked? Psalm 73, and I'm not going to quote Psalm 73 because I can't find any obvious creation theme. That, of course, is not what's written in the book. God, as Savior and Helper. Now, by the way, I do find the wicked in that psalm. So it kind of fits, but it fits as a part of a whole rather than looking at what creation has to do with the rest of it. Psalm 121 is the first of the songs of ascent, or pilgrimage psalms, that employs the phrase, "Who made heaven and earth?" This rare phrase is used three times in these psalms. The main themes of the songs of ascent are the greatness of God, his creative power, his help, and his act of sustaining his creation. The theme of dependence on the Lord in a hostile world is a recurring feature of the songs of ascent. And I'm just going to go skip through that, the whole commentary on that. Here is, "I will lift up mine eyes to the hills from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord which made heaven and earth." In many translations, this will be left, "From whence cometh my help?" I look at the hills. Is that where I'm supposed to look? No, apparently I'm supposed to look at that one who made them. And then it goes on to talk about, "He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber." And going on beyond that. Conclusions and implications. Conclusions. This study examined 12 creation themes found in the book of Psalms. It should be noted that these are not the only themes, but represent the primary, most clearly seen uses of the creation theme. They are not summarized in this conclusion. Rather, this conclusion serves as a summary of the overall implications of the use of creation in the book of Psalms, which could then be compared with the rest of the Hebrew Bible. The first observation is that the use of creation language widens the scope of the text. Suddenly, the text no longer speaks only to a specific group of people, but to all nations, and often includes even animals or other parts of creation. We saw that in the sons of Adam instead of the sons of Abraham. Second, creation themes always carry the subtext of praise and are often interrupted by spontaneous expressions of worship. It is a direct response to creation. When the psalmists consider the works of God's hands, their first response is praise. Third, the psalmists refer to creation as a historical fact. These writers believe that creation took place at the beginning and was the result of God's hand or God's word. Those who do not recognize creation as God's handiwork are called wicked. Fourth, creation is never perceived as an accident. Even when the psalmist questions the reason for creation, God assures him of a greater plan. Fifth, creation is always looked at from the perspective of a sinful world. It is entwined with a life-death cycle and imagery of a fallen planet, and thus usually represents a post-flood world. Sixth, it is interesting to notice that when creation is linked with humanity, it often emphasizes the fleeting state of being. However, when creation is seen in connection with God or his law, it highlights the eternal quality of both. Seventh, the Exodus story is often incorporated within the creation story. They are both the result of God's power and therefore evoke praise as a response. Finally, in comparison with other Near Eastern religions, creation theology in the Psalms emphasizes monotheism. Objects such as the sun, moon, stars, or seas are turned into created servants of God who not only do as he says, but also give him praise. I would rephrase that slightly. I don't think they are turned into created servants of God, but rather they maintain their original status as servants of God. Implications for the Genesis creation account. As demonstrated in this study, the book of Psalms includes numerous allusions to and echoes of the Genesis creation account. The numerous creation themes discovered in Psalms clearly underline the theological thrust of the Hebrew Bible. Creation and a creator are assumed. However, one wonders, what does the book of Psalms add to the biblical concept of creation? How did the psalmist understand the beginnings of our world? What follows is a succinct commentary on these questions based on the presented material. First of all, from the reading of Psalms, It is very clear that the authors believed in a literal creation that happened through the Word of God, especially as noted in Psalms 33 and Psalm 104. Basically, this was unquestioned until the 600-pound gorilla came into the room. Furthermore, God created the entire creation. Everything is part of His work. The psalmists leave no place for chance or an accident. God is the one who gave life and set the world in place. Creation Week, as such, is not clearly seen in the book of Psalms, aside from the implications of such a progression of creation in Psalm 104, which falls outside the focus of this study and has been dealt with in a separate chapter. On the other hand, there is also no indication of anything different from a literal seventh-day creation as described in Genesis 1. There is no alternative story. In the Psalms, the God of creation is a God of blessing. These blessings are immediate. In this way, God's power to create is seen in events that are sudden and immediate, as creation presumably was. Therefore, it could be argued that on the basis of present events, God created in the past in the same way. Therefore, the Psalms in an indirect way support the seven-day literal creation, or at least support a very short creation. The main addition to the Genesis account in God's sustaining power over His creation, the main addition to the Genesis account is, in the Psalms, presumably, is God's sustaining power over His creation. This does not mean that the creation was not finished in 7 days. Rather, it suggests that God did not excuse Himself after He finished His creation, but continued to be a caring Father and sustainer. All the occurrences of the creation theme in the Psalms are tied to present reality. The Genesis account ends with the seventh day. God saw that everything was very good and rested. The narrative continues by describing the entrance of sin, followed by God's immediate commencement of the process of saving a fallen world. He is present in the narratives, but the narratives do not stress His creative power. On the other hand, God continues to maintain His creation in the book of Psalms. He continues to create and renew a chaotic world. Many Psalms refer to this God as a sustainer. This is not a God who created physical substance and then stepped out to see what would happen. The psalmist stressed that God's ongoing creative power is evident in a newborn child, in a growing plant that is being watered by the rain, and even through anomalies in the natural world. In this way, the psalmist illustrates the fact that the world was created by God in the beginning and is being sustained by Him until the end. The Psalms never give any credence to a mythical creation. Creation is not based on metaphorical or symbolic ideas, but on solid facts, at least in the mind of the psalmist. These facts could be seen by the psalmist and can still be seen today. Literal creation in the Psalms is based on present reality. Therefore, the book of Psalms strengthens and builds on this historical force of creation, which was already established in Genesis. Humans are the wonderful work of God's hands. They exhibit God's wisdom. It is this understanding that causes the psalmist to praise and worship. Humankind has been set apart from other aspects of creation, but at the same time, all creatures have been created by the same hand of the Creator. Finally, the psalmists use creation themes to express their wonder over God's greatness. They do not satisfy the reader with absolute answers. They cannot explain every detail of God's creation. They can only marvel at the way it works. Thus, the book of Psalms suggests that not every event, every act, or every matter can be explained by scientific observation. This is Muráň's editorializing here. There are complexities that only God can understand. There are areas where His power is seen, but this power cannot be explained by study or observation. Ultimately, the psalmists leave the reader with a need to believe in God, the Creator. So he's making a clear claim that that science can't explain everything, which is probably fair. Now, my take on all this is the chapter does not focus on creation in the Psalms specifically, more on what it's used. It rather asks what the functions of the references to creation are with the various psalmists. It therefore avoids the usual polemics directly, which is probably a good way to go. kind of like that. Now, those of you who read carefully may have noticed that the heading was the creation in the Psalms, but that the original title was creation in selected Psalms. And that always raises a question for me, what are the unselected Psalms? Well, are they all selected for creation and that's it? Turns out, no. There's a few Psalms that didn't get into the chapter, and one of them is interesting, Psalms 19. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Clear reference to creation here. And it was kind of in a footnote, and that was the end of it. Day unto day uttereth speech, night unto night showeth knowledge. Most of this should be familiar with to many of you. There is no speech nor language, and their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. And them has he set a tabernacle for the sun, which is a bridegroom coming out of his chamber and rejoices as a strong man to run a race. Here you can see the sun running across the sky. His going forth is from the end of heaven, and his circuit unto the ends thereof, and there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. And of course the next part is the law of the Lord is perfect, and so forth. But as you read that, you realize this is clearly poetry, and it is clearly not literal. And why I say this is as important is, of course, because this is one of the verses where Galileo and the church got into a fight. Is this describing something real, or is this describing the way it looks to us? And of course, the church at the time said that it was the way it looks to us. It was real. Galileo said it was the way it looks to us. I don't know whether Muráň didn't want to get involved in that or whatever, but but it's interesting. And one of the ways I pay special attention to nothing is hid from the heat thereof, because we're going to come back to that. Excuse me. And here's another one. This is Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein, for he hath founded it upon the seas and hath established it upon the floods. Again, a clear reference to creation. But now it's kind of interesting because it kind of implies that the inside of the earth is water or something like that. And then 94... Psalm 94, verse 8. Understand ye brutish among the people, and ye fools, when will ye be wise? He that planteth the ear, shall he not hear? He that formed the eye, shall he not see? He that planteth the ear, obviously, and for some reason I didn't highlight he that formed the eye, but it deserves highlighting. That's a clear reference to creation as well, of course. God created our ears and our eyes, and therefore, of course, he sees. And he hears. And there's Psalms 92 and 93, which are kind of tangentially related, but a little more than some of the Psalms that he brings in. And then finally, one that is absolutely classic, Psalm 136, and I'm not sure how he missed this one. To him by wisdom, this is the 136, is the, his mercy endureth forever. Or his love endures forever, his steadfast love endures forever, depending on what translation you use. it's hesed, whatever you want to put into that word. To him that by wisdom made the heavens, for his mercy endureth forever. To him that stretched out the earth above the waters. To him that made great lights, the sun to rule the day, the moon and the stars to by night. I mean, that's a direct echo of the fourth day of creation. The great lights, the sun to rule the day, and the moon and stars to rule it not by night. Now this is kind of interesting also. Here again, the stretched out the earth above the waters. Are there waters under the earth? Maybe there were before the flood. It's an interesting point. Anyway, the omitted passages do lead to some difficulties. One of them is, how literally should we take poetry? There is nothing hid from the heat thereof. Well, not quite. There are actually caves that with a more or less vertical orientation where coolness comes down into them, and in fact, they stay frozen year-round. even though they're getting closer to the center of the earth and therefore should gradually heat up as you get down further. But the mechanics of it are that they cool down in the winter and they freeze, and in the summer they never get hot enough to melt. And so they're called ice caves. So it's not technically true that there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. Well, it's pretty close. It's a nice expression. If you allow for poetry to be in expressions, you can kind of get by with that. Psalms, I think it's fair to say, is not as complete as Genesis. It supports Genesis, but it can't replace Genesis. If we didn't have Genesis, we couldn't really reconstruct it from the Psalms. And that, of course, raises the question that, as we've seen in a couple of passages now, is the earth founded upon the seas? Well, if you allow this to be a poetic expression, then you can kind of say, well, the sea is lower than the earth, which is technically true. On the other hand, can we drill down and get water everywhere? Probably not. And so, again, I think one wants to take these as poetic expressions that don't necessarily, they don't lead to the kind of hard science that, could revolutionize our water supplies, for example. But that's my opinion, and now it's your turn. And I forgot to distribute these. But we have a comment back there, and we have another one back there. Go ahead.
I was fascinated by the sustaining part of the Psalms, because as I look at what happened at the cross, I tend to view what happened at the cross as an example of what happens when sin cuts you off from the sustainer of life, and therefore a perfect being that God had no excuse or no reason to require justification from, or the fact that he would kill a sinner, but the fact that the sin cut him off from God eliminates the image of an angry God that kills a sinner, because obviously he wouldn't be angry at his own son and angry at a perfect person that lived, but that the fact that sin separates you from God and that therefore separates you from that sustaining action. Had God built the world and disappeared, you wouldn't have a case for the fact that God sustains all of us here, and when we cut ourselves off from our sustainer, we die, as opposed to a legalistic approach of a justification, someone paying the price for sinning.
Mm-hmm. And we even have that kind of image that Jesus gives: "I am the vine, ye are the branches." That you take yourself away from God, you die, and it's not that God's being mean to you; it's just that you refuse to get sustenance from the only source there is.
Okay, when it talks about the waters under the earth and the earth over the waters, I was thinking that may come from the Noah's account of how the waters come from the deep, with the flood, and then there may be some references in Genesis, but they may have misread that, but I think there was a kind of a belief that there were waters under the earth. So
yeah, well, the thing to keep in mind is, again, if you're looking at this as a phenomenological thing, if there weren't waters under the earth, where would springs come from? So that in one sense, there is even today some water under the earth. It's just not very much, and it doesn't mean that you can drill down everywhere and get to water.
Right. Well, that's what I'm saying. They kind of maybe jump to maybe a conclusion that you could draw that it's everywhere, but even though it didn't say that.
Well, if you read poems in general, the Song of Solomon talks about a woman, beautiful woman, and she, there are various descriptions which, if taken literally, would, let's just say not be quite so beautiful. But we do this, my love is like red, red rose. Does that mean she has petals? I don't think so. And I think that the point of it is that we need to be careful of how hard we push these things. We need to understand the point that's being made rather than trying to make everything fit precisely.
Well, that's what I'm kind of saying. It may have been just a cultural belief. You know, like yeah. We have a lot of cultural beliefs now that really aren't biblical, but we still keep believing them.
That's true. I have a comment here and one down here. And then over.
There's a very interesting place out in the Borrego Desert that my brother and I came across, and it's a cave. We walked into that cave, and it showed outside where water had flowed out of it at one time. We got all the way to the back of the cave, and we found evidence where water had hit the roof, and we started searching and found a sinkhole at the very end of the cave. And when we put our ear to the sinkhole, we could hear a rushing water sound down deep in under the ground in the desert, indicating that there was some type of a river flowing underneath the Borrego Desert. We dropped rocks into it to try to hear a splash, and we could hear it bouncing a couple times, and then the sound disappeared, and we never even heard the splash of the rocks hitting the water down below. But we could hear the sound like a rapids down at the bottom, and it showed evidence that evidently when there was a flood season of some type, there would be enough pressure so that water would come up through this sinkhole, hit the roof of this cave, and flow out the cave, and you could see evidence outside the cave where water had come out of the cave. Very, very interesting, out in the middle of the Borrego Desert. Here was this cave with a stream underground.
Well, you know, I think it's pretty obvious to most people who look at it that there used to be a lot more water in some of the desert than there is now. So I think that's probably... true, and I know in Missouri, where we do have a lot of water, a lot of the time, those things are actually full, and they come out. And, for example, the Merrimack River just comes out of the ground at a giant spring. It's pretty amazing to look at. If we come in here, and I think we have one down here as well. Go ahead.
I had a comment.
Oh, okay. We'll let you comment.
Okay.
And then send it down to her.
Okay. Getting back to the point of sustenance, evolutionists have to do away with the second law of thermodynamics, temporarily at least, to get creation. Otherwise, entropy is going to take over and take things into disarray. So I wonder how they handle then the sustenance part of it. You know, they have to get rid of the second law of thermodynamics for the creation, but sustenance is just as important as the creation, I think. So how do they get around that little dilemma? Do you have some thought on that?
That's a problem for them, and I'm not going to expand on it too much. Go ahead, and then bring the mic down here. Go ahead.
Oh, I'm just going to refer to the, he skipped Psalms 24:2 about...
Before he's founded on the seas?
Yes, and he skipped 136:6, where it applies the same thing. And I'm wondering if this might not be interpreted, and I think Dick Davidson agrees with me on it. That it could represent the earth before the events of creation week. It's a Genesis 1, you know, the first thing, cheers an original earth with water.
Right.
And creation doesn't begin till Genesis 3, well, 1-3.
Right.
And Second Peter 3 goes to, but I agree, this is poetic literature. There's several ways to interpret it, but it does fit with the sequence you seem to find in Genesis.
Yeah.
1 verse 1 and 2 versus the rest of the creation account on verse 3, starting with verse 3.
If we were being extremely precise and not poetic, we would rather say the earth was founded besides the sea rather than on top of it. Because, you know, if you drill down, you're not going to find water nowadays most of the time. I mean, yeah, you occasionally get a little aquifer or something like that, but it's not like there's liquid water in massive amounts.
Strangely, there is no mention of the creation water in the Genesis account of creation. It's there first.
Yeah, the water is there to begin with. Although, interestingly enough, in one of the areas where it talks about the mountains that were formed already, apparently, and then were elevated, the mountains went, valleys sank down. That's Psalm 104, I think.
Yeah, it could apply either way to creation or the flood.
So again, I think one of the things that it's nothing hid from the heat thereof. I think you need to back off a little bit and take it as kind of sweeping generalizations rather than mathematical accuracies.
The subtitle here, 12 themes associated with creation. It doesn't say these are the texts that speak of creation. We're talking about things associated, and it is more of an essay than a research paper.
Yeah, it is.
But he's talking about themes associated with, and when you associate themes with creation, you, as the author, are doing the associating.
That's true, partly, but I think 136 belongs in there regardless because...
Oh, he just didn't get that far.
Yeah, he just didn't get that far, I guess.
Remember, he's a PhD student.
Right. Well, maybe he'll be looking at this video and we'll put it in his final PhD thesis. <won't>
I don't know what his PhD is. Not on the basis of this.
No,
this isn't a thesis. This is an essay.
Yeah, this would be probably a summary of a part of what he was doing. I'm sure this wouldn't work for the whole thing. But I'm guessing that the reason that they put it to him is because he was doing research in the area and
they needed a chapter from somebody from that part of the world.
You think so? Possibly, I guess. Well, the next guy is going to be Spanish, Angel Rodriguez. So, but then he's well known enough that it would be reasonable to put him in to actually do a chapter anyway. So I'm sure these people are at least partly based on their competence.
Oh, I'm sure. I'm just being silly.
Yeah. Comment here, and then there's one back there. Go ahead. Yeah. Keep your hand up so that the mic can find you. Go ahead.
Yeah, listening to you read this, I was struck by the number of references to the theme of the glory of God, the praise of God, a theme which is ubiquitous not only in the Psalms, but all of Scripture. I mean, I've been struck just by how many times that theme shows up.
Yeah, if you miss that, you got to be pretty dense.
Yeah. Now, knowing that, I'm thinking about the attempts by scientists nowadays to set up all these sophisticated contraptions to find intelligent life elsewhere in the universe. It seems conceivable to me, at least, to think that God, knowing what we know about God and his personality and the way he operates in general, that he, in fact, did create, chose one little tiny insignificant speck and one insignificant corner of the universe to create intelligent life, knowing full well that people like yourself and other researchers would in time delve into nature very deeply and be awestruck by that and glorify him and then act the way he usually acts for his own glory. Is that not conceivable?
I think that it's not only conceivable, but it's probable that, and in fact it's been not just people like me, if you go back far enough, you read that Ptolemy and people like that will tell you I mean, this is just common knowledge, that the stars are so far away from us that for mathematical purposes they can be considered a point. Basically, it's saying that effectively for us the stars are at infinite distance. So the awe of, you know, people back in those days of the stars was of the same order of magnitude as our awe. I mean, we put it back, you know, billions of light years. But then again, you know, for them, a day's journey was, you know, 25 miles, and that's as far as you go. You know, if you got horses, maybe you can get 50 or 100 miles, but that's it, you know. And, of course, nowadays, 100 miles is an hour's drive in the right places. Or maybe I should say the wrong places. Anyway.
Okay, so I remember that some people have said that the rocks under the earth are largely hydrated minerals. And if you added all that up, you'd have a tremendous amount of water.
There isn't as much water as you might think, and it's certainly not in the form of water. It's not the kind of thing that you'd expect, and nor is it the kind of thing that if you would, you know, somehow, let's say, heat those rocks, you could drive the water out and then drink it. Yes, there are hydrates, but they're a small fraction of what you'd normally have. And I'm not sure I would make the characterization. I would prefer to say that the psalmist is speaking in kind of generalities and doesn't intend to be pushed that far.
I just would say in defense, is this working?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it is now.
I would just say in defense of the author there, however he pronounces his name.
Muráň.
Muráň.
I don't know. We need an Eastern European here to help us out. No. No comments. Okay. I haven't run into a language that has an N with one of those little check things in it. So I have no idea where that's coming from. But anyway.
I just wanted to say, I think he's in a different matrix than we are here in this class. He's a theologian. He's not particularly interested in the science, and so he picked on themes that we're not as especially interested in as he would be. It's just
I agree with you.
It's just a different outlook.
I think in spite of that, even though, like I say, I can find little weaknesses here and there from our perspective, I would say that he's still done a pretty good job, and he's done quite a good job considering the aims that he has, and considering the fact that he's not aiming at what we're looking at precisely.
I think Psalms and looking at Isaiah, one is faith, the other one is science. Psalms is all poetic. We can take it literally. If we did the way Christ, he spoke his parables, if we took that literally, we'd be in deep trouble. Go to Isaiah chapter 40. He sits on the circle of the earth. He stretches the universe like a curtain. We're talking more of science, but then you go to Psalms, we're talking faith. You're talking poetry. We're going to take that literally.
Yeah, probably the most literal stuff that you can have, although even there you're talking about highly, is the Job speeches, and particularly where God talks to Job, where he kind of, you know, asks Job in a very poetic way, what do you know about anything?
Right. And Slovakian.
It's Slovakian. Okay. It is Eastern Europe. We got that part right anyway. I have no clue as to what it is. And we have a comment here.
Sorry, I'm still hung up on the sustenance part. And to me, it's just as important as it's right in there with creation, the homeostasis and the ability to self-maintain and to heal and all the other things that this creation was set up with.
Well, it
doesn't just self-maintain. It has to have an overseeing power and input to keep it going. I'm awestruck.
You know, I would agree. I suture people occasionally, and they heal. You can't do that on a cadaver. Doesn't work. And that's really important. I mean, I don't fix lacerations at all. I just put them in close enough so that nature can take over. Where'd that come from? And there isn't really a good answer.
Man dresses the wound and God heals.
That's correct. And then there's a comment behind, I guess. And did you have a comment as well or not? No.
Ellen White says, not a heartbeat, not a blossoming of a bud takes place except for the power of God.
Yeah, and it is by the power of God that breath follows breath and heartbeat follows heartbeat, which means that he's intimately... Well, Jesus said that. He said the number of hairs that you have are numbered, you know. You know, you lost 367 today. I mean, it's amazing to think about that. You know, I am sure that if Jesus were to speak to today's audience, and he would tell you that electron doesn't get displaced without his knowing what's going on. And I mean, it's the detail that God has is just phenomenal, and he keeps it going. And he keeps it going through laws that we can understand so that you can do science and you can understand how it works and you can work with it. But he is in control. And I think that flows from the fact that he's a creator. Or maybe it's part of the same general point. And I think that when people lose the idea that he's a creator, they tend to lose the idea that he's a sustainer at the same time, and probably for some of the same reasons. Well, looks like we've reached the end for today. So come back next week, and we're going to be talking about the female part of the Godhead.